Good morning. Good morning, Diane. Are you well? That's good. Good to see you all. Great to see you all. And I'm feeling a bit guilty, I have to say, because I took a service in First Church this morning, and I left at 10 past 11. Now, and I started just about on time, and I feel I shortchanged them a little bit, you know. I didn't extemporize as much as I normally do, but I think I owe them something. Next time I better go a little bit over my time, although maybe they're very happy with the 40 minutes. No, I don't think we'd like 40 minutes. Would we? Okay. Well, on that bombshell, I'll get started. Now, what do I normally say? Oh, yeah. Welcome. I've said welcome. I've said that bit. And let us do all the things we normally do, pray, worship, and sing together, which is the reason we're here. Now, I'm going to do something a little bit different this morning with the opening prayer. Often I take weddings which are mixed. Now, in Northern Ireland, that means a Catholic and a Protestant. In other countries, it might mean something more exotic. But in Northern Ireland, a Catholic or a Protestant and a Protestant. And always I ask people if they would like sort of both traditions represented in the wedding service. And more often than not, the Catholic partner will ask me to do prayers of the faithful, which is a nice idea, where the family come up and they say prayers for those who are deceased, prayers for those who couldn't come here, and prayers for the couple getting married. And at the end of each little prayer, they say, Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. So now, you can say it out loud if you like. You don't have to. Or you can say it to yourself. Or you needn't say it at all. But I'm going to do a little thing, a universal prayer for the faithful. So let us pray. Gracious God, we pray for the work and service of all care homes and day centers for the elderly and sick people, and for those carers who look after family and friends in their own home. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, we pray for the many charitable organizations who raise money and provide support services for all those in need, for the homeless, for those suffering depression, and for illnesses and cancer. So many things that we can say. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, we pray for all findings in everybody's life, whether they're painful, whether they are lonely or uncertain, especially those who are ill or vulnerable. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, we pray that your wisdom and your comfort in times of need will bless all our families, bless all our friends, and bless our lives in this beloved city. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, we pray for all those who are struggling in their lives. Bring them hope of an end to their sufferings and a resolution of their difficulties. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, Show us the best way to help those who suffer without being intrusive, but without simply turning away from their pain. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Amen. And now may we sing together our first hymn, and it's number 6 in the Red Book, Ye Holy Angels Bright.
Good morning. This week I'm going to share with you a reading from Benedictus by John O'Donoghue. I'm sure you all know who that is. We've read from his book quite a few times. But this week I've had seen a few times people who've had to struggle through things, maybe very quietly, maybe very patiently, not wanting to make a fuss about things. So I want to read this morning, and it's called For Suffering. May you be blessed in the holy names of those who, without you knowing it, help to carry and lighten your pain. May you know serenity when you are called to enter the house of suffering. May a window of light always surprise you. May you be granted the wisdom to avoid false resistance. When burdens knock at the door of your life, may you glimpse their eventual gifts. May you be able to receive the fruits of suffering. May memory bless and protect you with the hard-earned light of past travail, to remind you that you have survived before, and though the darkness now is deep, you will soon see approaching light. May the grace of time heal your wounds. May you know that though the storm might rage, not a hair of your head will be harmed. Amen.
Thank you, and welcome back, choir. That was lovely. And Sheena has a few words she'd like to say.
Good morning, All Souls. As most of you probably know, Louise and I have had to discontinue Kids Club. As in from this month, and the reason being there are no kids. Now this is very sad, but it's also a fact of life. Busy families with two parents working are taking the Sabbath literally as a day of rest, and they're not going to church. So if any kids do appear in church, of course we'll take them downstairs and amuse them, but that's over for now. So then Louise and I were wondering, well, what else could we do in the church? And there's something that's fairly obvious, and that's the fact that we are a university parish. The university's just up the road, the end of our street, in fact. And this is a very good time because next week is Freshers' Week. Now, in Freshers' Week, there are about 5,000 new students coming to Queen's. Now, they'll not all be at Freshers' Week, but a lot of them will be, and there'll be a lot of footfall right past our door. So it seems like a really good time for us to be doing something for students. Now, I know there are other churches in the vicinity. There's the Crescent Church and there's Fisherwick that do things for students like free lunches. But I think we've got something really unique to offer. And in fact, when we started thinking about what is All Souls, what do we believe? Of course, we turned to Roger, who's written on the matter. And Roger has put together six principles, and then Alan and I have tweaked them a little bit, and I think they're up on the screen for you there. So, of course, we've okayed these with Chris, and he approves what we're saying here. But this is what we believe here in All Souls, and this is what we would be offering to people if they became part of our community. So we're a diverse and inclusive community seeking after truth. We don't believe we have the truth. We're looking and seeking, and we accept light from any quarter, and everyone's truth is as good as everyone else's. We recognise that everyone has their own view of God. There's no particular view, again, that's the best one. So again, we will accept what other people have to say. We are inspired by the life of Jesus. We believe that Jesus lived, and we believe that he gave his life as the ultimate sacrifice in terms of loving those around him, and that's what we're aspiring to do, live like Jesus. We don't judge anyone. We're not inviting people to come in the doors of our church so that they can repent and become, you know, part of a creed. We are very accepting of everybody as they are. In fact, we really love doubt and questioning. And personally, I think doubt is a sign of maturity in a person's life. We welcome diversity, particularly from those who have been excluded from society. We believe that our life's work is to make a better world. So we're involved with the here and now. We're not worried about the hereafter. We're worried about what are we going to do today? What are we going to do tomorrow? And we are hoping by our contributions to make a better world with peace, liberty, and justice for all. And then I added the last one, working to protect our beautiful world, because I adore nature. So what are we actually offering to anyone who would come through our doors? Well, the first thing we're offering them is non-judgmental friendship. There are lots of students, particularly now when so many of the students at Queen's are from overseas, who come here, they haven't a friend in the world, they have no family, and to have a church where we would accept them, warts and all, would be something very special for them. The second thing is we've actually got two people in our own congregation who have offered to give English lessons. One is Alec, and one is Susan, and they are going to, if anyone wants them, they're going to give English lessons to overseas students to help them on their way at the beginning of their time in Queen's. And the third thing we're going to offer is a free lunch. Now, well, you already do this, but I mean, as everybody knows, you know, food's the way to attract people into any organisation. And so we're going to do soup and sandwiches at the end of the month whenever student funds are at an all-time low. So what we have done so far is we've got together a little group of people, and we have planned a banner, which is going to be 4 foot by 3 foot, hanging over the newly painted church fence. Susan is going to do some exciting things, who knows what, knowing Susan, in the church grounds. And I know from years and years of presenting medical conference stalls that people love food. So we really need food. We need cookies, we need brownies, we need shortbread. Have something out to make students stop and to entice them to engage with us. So that's the one thing that I would be really grateful of. Anybody who's here this morning, it's next Tuesday, next Wednesday, next Thursday, from 10:30 to 3:30. And if we could get a couple of people to stand at the stall, that would be fantastic. Louise and I will be there. Hopefully other people will be there too. But if we could have a couple of people at all times to talk to students who are walking past, particularly on the Tuesday and the Thursday. The Wednesday's a sports day, and I'm not sure those students will be particularly interested in us. But that's the plan. There are lists down at the back. And if anybody wants to sign up, we will be eternally grateful to you. So thank you very much for listening. And for those of you who pray, please pray that a few students at least will stop and talk to us. And that's the plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sheena. And it's a great idea. It's a tough idea, and the best of luck with it. Is it just me, or did I count 7 principles? Yeah, okay. You snuck an extra one in, Roger, did you? Anyway, the principles are brilliant, and we could do a lot of work around the principles ourselves because they are. They really do reflect who we are. And on that bombshell, the second reading I picked for today is from Leo Tolstoy, and it's Wise Thoughts for Every Day. You may recall last week I used a poetry book that had a poem for every day. And it's a brilliant idea, that, because it's a free card for the second reading. You don't have to look up a second reading. You look up a date, and that will be the reading. The problem is, what if you don't particularly necessarily believe in the second reading, or in the reading that's designated for today, the September the 15th? And when I read it, I thought, I don't know. And then I thought, well, maybe I'll read Tolstoy's thought for yesterday, or I'll read one for tomorrow. And I said, no, that's cheating. Stick to the one that's in the book. Stick to the one that he wrote for today. And it's interesting, because he spent the last number of his years of his life pulling this little book together, reading all the other great thinkers. He was a friend of Chekhov and Maxim Gorky. So they influenced a lot of these readings that he put together. And it's also interesting, because when the communists came to power, this little book was banned. It was banned because it was such a revolutionary book, and all it is Gentle Thoughts for Every Day by Leo Tolstoy. And this one is called Soul for September the 15th. Scholars were digging in an ancient burial ground and found several kernels of wheat, which they planted and watered. Suddenly, each kernel began to understand it was at the same time both a seed and a sprout. We are talking about the life of the spirit after death. If the spirit can live after death, then it must have lived before birth. One-sided eternity makes no sense. There is the beginning of life, my inner spirit, inside me. I clearly understand the limits of my body and vaguely understand the limits of the spirits of others. Still vaguer is my understanding of the spirit living in animals. Yet even vaguer is my feeling for inanimate objects. I do not sense their spirits, but feel that the beginning of the world that gives life to all of us exists everywhere. Now, as I say, I only picked that up a day or two before, so I've got to revisit it over and over again to really try and understand what Tolstoy is saying there. And if anybody has any idea, equally, because he talks about the afterlife, the before life, I would be very interested in hearing how you interpret that. Now, may we sing together. Oh, no, we won't. No, we won't. We're going to pray. Now, let us pray. As we gather in prayer, may we remember that prayer alone means little without inspiring action. May we always remember that true religion is not in rites or hymns or even prayers. The holiest worship of all is a loving, peaceful, generous life. Feeding the hungry, comforting the sick and the bereaved, sheltering the homeless, loving others as we love ourselves. May we do all these things whenever called upon to do so. And may we thus make everywhere we go a temple to that which we worship, and every day a holy day. So let us honor you, Spirit of Love, in the highest way of all. Amen. And now may we stand in body or in spirit as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we may stay standing. And now may we sing together our second hymn in the Red Book 323, O God of Bethel.
Thank you.
How can you say you love God whom you've not seen, but hate your brother whom you have seen? We often quote this text as an absolute in the Christian faith to underscore the essential need to love each other as a way of loving God. But of course, in life, nothing is as simple as it seems, because the text is very smart and clever and obvious and common sense, but it's not always that easy to live according to that text. Often, we detest our brother, and indeed, maybe even our neighbor, because of exaggerated differences. I mean, even within the royal family of this United Kingdom, it would appear that two brothers are incapable of speaking to each other, William and Harry. And that reflects, indeed, many families and communities. Philip McGarry, writing the other day, used the term narcissism of small differences, that on a personal level, or even on a communal level, we build up the small differences to exaggerate the differences between us, and we accuse the other lot of all sorts of shenanigans that we would never dream of doing. So I thought that was a great way to finish up an article using the narcissism of small difference. Indeed, Philip's brother is no less but Tim McGarry, the comedian, and he actually put up on social media that the mistake the GAA made was in calling it Casement Park. They should have called it Cromwell Park, and they would have got the money a lot quicker to build it. I remember reading Eureka Street by Robert McLean Wilson, a really good book. We should consider it in the book club, Eureka Street by Robert McLean Wilson. And I remember a comment he said, or he made when he was being interviewed, I think it was on the BBC. And this is going back to the time of the height of the Troubles. He said people would gather and all shout abuse at each other, and then they'd throw maybe the odd rock or stone at each other, and then look at their watches and race home, all of them, to watch EastEnders or Coronation Street, because that was the real love in their life, not their cultural or religious differences, but what was going on in Coronation Street or EastEnders. Now, I don't want to underestimate the significant cultural difference, but I do believe we have to be aware of the exaggeration of differences. I remember one time myself and Isabella were getting a taxi to Dublin Airport, and the taxi driver, who was a great fan of the GAA, and Dublin had just played a northern team, I think it was Armagh, more than likely was Armagh, in football, Gaelic football. And this driver, Maliki, said to me, he said, they're not the same as us. They're dirty. They can't play the game fair. And I said, what, just Armagh? No, all of them across the border, he said. They shouldn't be allowed to come down here to play us in football. They're not like us. And I was kind of slightly inspired, because this was a GA man talking about GA people in the north, that they were a different lot. Again, exaggerating a simple difference. Now, having said that, I have heard that northern teams are not the fairest people to play against. Now, I don't want to go down that road, but I've heard it said. by Dublin fans, of course. I mean, if you think of one of the differences, is in the saying of the Lord's Prayer, like adding a couple of lines at the end of the Lord's Prayer, is a huge cultural difference. Darrow Brin, the comedian, he said, when you're at a mixed marriage, where a Catholic is marrying a Protestant, and just when the Catholics get, before the final two lines, the Catholics go, Amen, and are just about to sit down, and the Protestants look at them and go, For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever, Amen. Gotchas. Have you ever seen that? You probably haven't. We see it in football, with shouting as lads, as traitors. We saw it with Declan Rice and Jack Grealish last week, or 2 weeks ago, when Ireland was playing England in football, and the booing at Grealish and Rice. And last week, I was having a pint in a pub in Dublin, and I was a bit unfair to the young waiter, and he was a real football fan. And I said to him, we got talking about the football, because Ireland had just lost to Greece, the Republic of Ireland lost to Greece last weekend. And he said to me about the match, and I said, all the booing for God Save the King, what was that about? Ah, well, he says, you got to understand, he said, like 25 years ago, the English fans ran amok in Dublin. I said, oh, so all these new millennials knew all about that 25 years ago. Oh, well, no, he said, it was a bigger issue than that. Grealish and Rice, he said, like, what they did was terrible. Not only did they take off the green jersey, but they played for England, and the two of them scored. And he said, that was so unfair. I said, but they're supposed to score. That's the idea of the game. Against Ireland, haven't played for Ireland. And then I said to him, but you're half the Irish team are from England anyway. Right enough they are. And I said, how many of them played maybe for the England under-18s? Right enough, you're right. I still doesn't forgive Grealish and Rice. So that was the end of it. He was, as far as he was concerned, they deserved to be booed at. And another friend of mine said to me about the rugby. He said, you know, it's terrible at Lansdowne Road now. Or no, Lansdowne's okay because we sing the Irish national anthem, Aran Aveen, the soldier song, at Lansdowne Road. But now when Ireland plays abroad, because of the Northerners on the team, we have to be sensitive to them. And we have to sing that old thing from Derry. What's it? Stand Up for Ireland, Ireland's Call. He says, that's a dreadful song. Why can't we sing our national anthem, Aran Aveen? So I said to him, well, you know it then. What, the Irish national anthem, Sinn Leicre Fáil, Atofa Yael Ag Éireann. And he says, oh, no, I don't know it. I don't know the words of it. And I said, and what do? Well, he says, I can hum it in Irish. So there you go. So how can I say I hate my brother and sister whom I can see, but love God who I cannot see? And yet we seem to be able to do it every day. I love God, yet hate his brother. Anyone who says that is a liar. He loves God whom he cannot see and hates those who he can see. It's written down in 1 John 4. And yet it's the most difficult thing in Scripture to abide by. However, there is hope. I think the world is becoming better, a happier place. There are many good things happening as well as all the bad things. I'm trying to think of all the good things that are happening. Well, Trevor's back. Great. That's a good thing. Welcome back, Trevor. But I believe that Philip McGarry is absolutely correct when he mentions the narcissism of small differences. We have more in common here in Northern Ireland than we have different from each other. And we should seek common ground where we can. It won't be on every issue, but there can be common ground on so many things. It's not always easy to find common ground, but it's the only way we can travel. There isn't an alternative. Yes, I try to find common ground with everyone. In Corinthians, these words are spoken. In Corinthians 9, 22 and 22-23. Yes, I try to find common ground with everyone, doing everything I can to save some. I do everything to spread the good news and share in its blessing. Can you imagine if we, irrespective of our background, gave our blessing to others' endeavors? Is that possible? Imagine if we were able to transcend our opposition to one thing and another. That unionist politicians would actually come out and bless and cheer the Irish street name signs. And that nationalists would insist that the Union flag should fly 365 days on City Hall. That's over-optimistic, but that's the sort of thing, being generous to the other side. But unfortunately, we live in a zero-sum society. If they're getting it, we must be losing it. And if we're getting it, they must be losing it. So those things sound simple, yet it's not impossible to be generous each to the other. Now, there are modest baby steps that people take, and that is as much as we can hope in our search for common ground. But I believe we have to keep going. We have to do what we're called upon to do as Christians. How can you say you love God but hate your brother if God commands you to love your brother and make every endeavor by each community and those not from the two prominent communities? Make every endeavor they wish to carry out, one that's blessed by all, as we seek common ground. Amen.
It's good to be back. Thank you for that unexpected welcome. September, I think, is the most melancholic of months, and the autumn season being ushered in. And we think of all the Septembers in our past lives and the new starts we made and the things we're going to do in the coming season. So, a little melancholic song, and it's called Try to Remember. Nana Muscuri, she wasn't my Nana, but she was a singer from Greece originally, and she had a big hit with this way back in the 1970s. So, but it's an attractive tune. I hope you enjoy it. Try to Remember.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Trevor. And now just a couple of notices. Well, Sheena has already spoken to you about the Freshers' Week and how we'll be engaging with the students. So anyone who wishes to help Sheena, talk to her after the service. Now, also next Sunday at 3 p.m. in the Dunmurray Church, there's a special service marking the opening of the Macmillan Library, which is called after the late Reverend Bill Macmillan, a great friend of All Souls. And everybody's invited, and there'll be refreshments afterwards. So if you're going, if you intend to go, maybe just tell me so I can let them know the numbers going from here, so they can, as they're preparing the refreshments. So that's 3 p.m. next Sunday afternoon in Dunmurray Church. They are also holding a quiz night, but I'll put that information up on our with our service on our in our email. And choir rehearsals, are they starting tomorrow? Choir rehearsing tomorrow evening. And if anyone wishes to be part of the choir, please talk to Trevor. The choir are always happy to welcome new members into the All Souls Choir. So, Trish, have you any notices? You're all right. Alan? Nothing? Okay. Well, that's it. Now we'll take our... Oh, Michael. Sorry.
Announcement. It's more courtesy. Sunday of next week, the Belfast Half Marathon is running. It's going to affect anyone travelling through parts of the Lower Ormo, around Ormo Park, and parts of East Belfast. You'll find more details online. I'd meant to print them out, but I forgot.
Thank you for that. Yeah, Michael, thank you for reminding us of that. And now we'll take our collection. And now may we sing together our final hymn. In the Red Book, it's hymn number 42. God of mercy, God of grace.
Thank you.
We are a free people. We have created for ourselves a place of free thought, love, and hope. May we go out from here unashamedly greeting all as our brothers and sisters. Amen. God bless you all. Go in peace.